Let's take a look at what Microsoft has announced for Power Platform for the Wave 1 2024 release. And as you might expect, there's a fair bit of Copilot in here. There's also some other AI features that I'm going to come to at the end around AI Builder that I think are underrated and worth knowing about. But let's kick off here with Power Apps and the top feature for me in the Power Platform release, which is this one. Fair bit to unpick here, but essentially the Copilot that we've had up till now, you can come in and just create one Dataverse table and an app over the top, which is lovely, but really not making full use of Dataverse. Take a look at this. Now, there's more than one thing here. Firstly, the Copilot experience is able to take this prompt, help me manage my beer recipes, batches, and inventory. I apologize for the fuzziness of the image. Unfortunately, the images we get with the new release, not the clearest, have done my best. I'd rather bring you these images than nothing. So, but look at this at the top here. It's actually creating not just a data table with relationships, which of itself is amazing, but also showing you a diagram. Hooray. This is something I've had so many people ask when we learn how to work with Dataverse. Can I visualize the relationships and so on? So this looks like that's what we're going to be able to get. So this allows you to create tables in Dataverse from scratch, from Excel, from SharePoint lists, from natural language conversation, and it will actually create multiple tables and visualize the ERD. More to come on this. As soon as I get my hands on this and there's more details, watch this channel, subscribe. I'm going to be covering this one a lot because this is really properly now Copilot being a game changer. Creating one table was nice. Creating multiple tables in an ERD. Thank you. Good one. Next, we have something slightly less exciting than this, but a really important feature here. And there's a couple of references throughout the Power Platform release to similar things. I've just picked this one, which is around being able to share more easily. So if you're building apps using Dataverse, the sharing of the tables, there's a lot of security and permissions underneath, which is a real strength of Dataverse. But actually then when it comes to sharing, people get confused, and it is quite confusing because you have to set all of that up. So the promise here is that you will be able to do this as easily as you can just share a document of some kind. So lots of references to this type of ease of ability to share in there. What we're seeing there is an example of the current sharing screen. So that should become a whole lot easier. And this one I love as well, which is around being able to have better mobile offline capability. And this is something that comes up a lot in the platform. If you are a user or you're working with users who have to go into remote areas or areas where there's very little mobile signal, this is really important. So this is going to give you more granular control over your Dataverse tables when you're building those apps, that you'll be able to select which columns you want to make available to download on the mobile app rather than just saying this whole table and there's a bunch of stuff in there that you don't really need. So this is an important part of performance about your apps. Now, bonus, if you've watched me before, you know that when I do a top 10, you're always getting more than 10. And I think there's probably about 15 in my top 10 here. So this is my bonus for Power Apps. Microsoft have released the release plan, as they always do, but then they've also released some videos, and the Power Platform Wave 1 2024 highlights video has a bunch of stuff in it that I can't see actually listed in the Wave 1 release plan. So, you know what? No rules. I make my own rules here. If Microsoft has put out a video saying this is Wave 1 2024 release highlights, I'm counting that as part of the announcement. This was in there. Inside Power Apps Canvas apps here, you've got a formula, explain this formula, and then it explains it. So that's using that GPT functionality to explain what's going on with formulas. Really good for learning, troubleshooting, understand what's going on in the app. I don't know where that one was announced or if it's coming, but that was in the video. So, and I love it. I wanted to make sure that you saw it. Power Pages here. This one actually is possibly, I know I'm running this in an order where this is sitting at number 4, but I think this is possibly the second biggest announcement out of the release wave here. At the moment, if you want to create Power Pages, portals, you have to use Dataverse. This allows you now to use virtual tables, which means you can start from a SharePoint list. See on the right-hand side there? Now we've got the data in the SharePoint list, and you can build your portal or your power pages based on that. Now, it's not going direct from SharePoint. It doesn't subvert any of the licensing or anything. This is very similar to the concept of being able to use SharePoint virtual tables in your model-driven apps. So it's an extension of that, but that's going to open up more availability and use cases, I think, for Power Pages, which is great. Now, again, I've kind of cross-checked the video and the release notes. The release notes say you can create virtual tables using SQL Server and Microsoft SharePoint. But this is what I also saw in the video. Salesforce Oracle. I don't know. Well, we'll see what happens. Again, can't find those things named anywhere. Maybe that's a future state, a screen mock-up, I'm not sure. In any case, we've definitely got an announcement here for Power Pages of using virtual tables, definitely SharePoint and SQL, but watch this space and let's see what else comes through. Now, the Power Automate section here is an entire bonus section of Copilot for Power Automate. All of these things have come out of that video and I think they're awesome. So let me take you through. This is a 3-for-1 at number 5. I've got to go back and add up how many features I'm bringing you here. Like I said, I make my own rules, my video, my channel. This first one here is something around using Power Automate with Windows Copilot. So Windows Copilot, I haven't gotten into much yet, but this ability to do things on your machine, like change to dark mode, open Spotify, you can work with all of those apps there. So I'm actually quite delighted to see this, allow Windows Copilot to run a Power Automate flow. So you can do that from Windows. This is presumably going to be more useful for those personal productivity type scenarios. There is something else in the release notes that looks like a bit of a repeat about an improvement coming to the experience of Power Automate in Excel. So I'm seeing Power Automate sort of go down into those everyday office applications, which is really interesting. So this is something that I'm really excited about, to be able to sort of run flows from that other context of just inside Windows. The other one I spotted in the video is this one here, Power Automate Copilot. All the examples we've seen so far are describe the automation you want to build. When a form is submitted, please send me a notification. But this one was a brewery example that they were using throughout the video. If you look at the prompt here, it says, I'm making beer and want to monitor the brewing process. So that's describing a problem statement that's broader than an automation. Again, not announced anywhere. Watch this space. And then that's what it comes up with, is building out that flow in the same way that you would hope for. And the other one is this error messaging. This might have been announced somewhere and I might have missed it, but you know, while I'm showing you things, I hadn't come across this before, showing the error in Copilot. And this error is actually much more user-friendly than the way it's currently done. So I'm really looking forward to that. I find error messages inside Power Automate do require a decent level of technical depth or troubleshooting. Please make this be real. Natural language error description would be a very, very good use of AI. Copilot Studio, formerly known as Power Virtual Agents, but it's had a massive uplift and a heap of things going on in here. We have got a couple of new features here that I'm really excited about. Use generative AI insights and other analytics enhancements to improve your Copilots. Essentially, what you're going to be able to do here is have analytics on how your Copilot is working, which is really important, especially the more that you're starting to use these bots and AI tools to help out your users, whether that's internal or customers, that you have clear metrics on what's working, where people are happy or not, and the ability to take action and improve on those things. And then the other one here that's awesome is some more channel support. I know WhatsApp comes up a lot in certain industries, so this is going to have now channel support to deploy your Copilot on WhatsApp, as well as your communication services, which also allows you to have native SMS in there. So more of that ability to get stuff into the hands of users on apps on their phone. Now, AI Builder, I want to really take some time here in the last three features. Don't run away. This is important. AI Builder is a piece of the platform that we were all excited about maybe 3 or 4 years ago. Look at this. It can process documents. It can process forms. It can do all of these cool things. But in amongst all of the bigger AI announcements last year, this is something that came up that I'll admit I haven't taken as much time on as I would like to, but I'm going to. AI Builder GPT prompts. So this is a newer part of the AI Builder capability. So you can use AI Builder in flows in Power Automate to you know, trigger and automate things. So you can have things coming in that will, you know, read an incoming document and get the metadata and push it out. Concept here is that you can have a GPT prompt in here where you're setting up something with variables and bits and pieces in there so that your AI builder can actually generate text. So it's using those GPT models and whatever prompts you're putting in there, including the idea of this, it's called like a meta prompt, where you're putting something in that you are informing it how it should deal with the input. So you've got inputs from the user or from the flow that can include these variables and this meta prompt that's giving it instructions, and then your flow can output generated text content using AI Builder. I'm going to do some videos on this. Let me know if you're interested in that in the comments. Hopefully you are. I am. So this is an example of it. So we've got three features here. There's actually quite a lot coming into this. Most of what's in this release wave was sort of pushed out from the previous release wave, but I picked out three things here that are awesome, that are new, that I think really change where this is going. So the first one is that you will be able to use it with documents. The first stage of this will be that you'll have this prompt like this that you're creating, and you will be able to attach a file in there for it to work with. Everyone wants to use AI with their business documents, their policy documents, all of those sorts of things. So this is going to be another avenue to explore where we'll be able to use documents with a GPT generative AI experience. These ones don't have a lot of information in the release notes, so I'm interpreting them as best I can. Prompt building supports few-shot learning. So few-shot learning is a way that you can give the model a small amount of data, a small amount of examples to train it in something specific. It's a lot easier and cheaper and quicker than really properly fine-tuning and customizing models. So this is a really useful thing to be able to use. So AI Builder prompts are going to be able to handle few-shot learning. And then last but certainly not least, that you will be able to define an output. So at the moment, you can only have text output, whereas what you're going to be able to do now is have JSON, PowerFX, and Power cards. So that's going to give you a heap of other formats. Tell me what you think. What are your top features here? Anything else in the release notes that you have missed? And if you are on the dynamic side of things, you might like to check out my summary video of the new release wave highlights here too. As always, thanks for watching.